bold claims, ladies and gentlemen. This is it. The Apple Mac Mini with their new Apple Silicon M1 processor. That's right, my friends. Apple says CPU performance up to 3 times greater, GPU performance up to 6 times greater, and neural processor machine learning performance up to 15 times greater. That's right. All of that and more can be yours for just, what is it, $699? $699 US? Is that right? Well, from the outside, it's a Mac Mini, all right. Wow, yeah, really not much to make it stand out from the previous Mac Minis that we've been using here at the office as ingest stations for a better part of a year now, I guess. Black stand, got a little cover over the I/O, and this is, of course, where the disappointment starts. Now, it's nothing to do with the performance of the Apple Silicon M1, but for me, one of the big highlights of the latest generation Mac Minis has been the ability to equip them with 10 gigabit networking. That's something that we use specifically for our use case where we wanted macOS footage ingest stations that we can offload footage from to our network storage. Unfortunately, for whatever reason, and I'm sure this is something that's going to be explored in depth over the coming weeks, Apple was not able to, or didn't want to, equip the new M1 Mac with a 10 gigabit option even, so you're stuck with 1 gig networking. You've got 2 Thunderbolt ports, although exactly what is different about them we don't know, but we do know they have no support for external GPUs, at least at this time. HDMI, a couple of USB 3 ports, which normally I would gripe about, but you've got Thunderbolt, which is also a Type-C / USB 4. The nomenclature's getting really confusing there, so you can break these out into a dongle or whatever the case may be. A cooling vent, as well as a headphone jack. Now, Apple, to my knowledge, has only really quoted performance per watt, at least on the product page, assuming a 10 watt TDP for the M1 chip. But what we also know is that it could potentially be configured with a greater TDP, and that's something we'd be more likely to see on a device that doesn't have to rely on a battery for power. For all I know, they might just go with the same approach on all of them just to keep things from getting confusing. Of course, there's a power button, and before we even fire it up, I kind of want to open it up. You got that iFixit kit? Yep. Yeah, just like Apple. Apple likes iFixit kits too. You guys see that? Ah, the delicious irony of Apple featuring iFixit in their promotional video launching the M1 processor. I personally really enjoyed that. Wait, before we do that, maybe I should at least finish unboxing the thing. So we got a power cable. Nice environmentally conscious packaging though. All of this appears to be paper. Quite literally all of it. That's fantastic. This video is brought to you by Private Internet Access. PIA is a VPN that allows you to access services and websites as though you were in a different country. It encrypts all of your internet traffic and uses a safe, protected IP and allows you to connect up to 5 devices at once with clients for Windows, macOS, that's right, Android, iOS, and Linux. Buy a 1-year plan for $39.95 and get 3 months for free at the link in the video description. Appears to be some kind of cover for the wireless antenna. Ah, that makes sense because the entire rest of this device is encased in metal and your Wi-Fi won't work very well like that now, will it? Are you excited to see the insides, Andy? Yeah? Please tell me this is just taped on. Sorry, give me a sec here. Oh, cool, it just pops out. Sorry, I couldn't really get you a good look at that. See, it just goes into these little clips. And then it looks like they've given you enough slack, almost. Yeah, there you go, to just put it aside and get access to the inside. Wow, there is a whole heck of a not a lot in here. Wow, got a little speaker right there. Got a little CMOS battery right there. So this is the power supply right over here. Cooling fan. If Apple was a PC manufacturer, they would probably say, oh wow, look at all the space we've got in here. We could put like a, you know, 2.5-inch drive bay for expansion. For all I know, this thing doesn't even have a SATA controller on it though. I don't see why it would. I mean, that's the thing. When you make your own bespoke silicon, you don't have to build in any legacy or unnecessary features that you're not planning to use in your devices. So why would you have a SATA controller? Look at this, the cooler is like half of the internals. If nothing else, ladies and gentlemen, Can you respect the cable management? I mean, yeah, it only has four cables or whatever, but boy, are they boy, are they managed. Now, Anthony needs to do thermal testing in our full review of this thing, which means that I unfortunately cannot pop the heatsink off of the SoC, as much as I would love to look at it. But with everyone out there who got units early already covering this thing, I'm sure you'll be able to find a picture of it if you really want to. Okay. I guess I just voided the warranty, probably.
Oh, no.
Well, what? What did you think was gonna happen, Jono? You gave me an iFixit kit and a Mac Mini. You think the warranty was gonna be intact by the time I was done?
Yes.
All right. Well, that's it. That's the whole darn main board. As we talked about in our coverage of Apple's launch event for their M1 Max, which I was not a fan of, by the way, anytime a company comes out and presents unlabeled graphs or vague comparisons against their competitors, I find it A, suspect, and B, just unnecessary. If you're confident in your product, just come out and give us the real goods. I mean, either way, I've got it in my hands now, so soon enough, we're gonna be able to run our own comparisons. But as we discussed in that video, there is not a whole lot to this. No M.2 expansion slot or even proprietary expansion slot. No SODIMM slot. That was something that we were a big fan of on the previous Mac Mini. Sorry, I don't really have a great angle for you of the back of the board there, but you'll have to trust me. There's no SODIMM slot. That's another really funny thing. I saw people kind of criticizing me for complaining about that. They were like, Linus, MacBooks haven't had upgradable memory in years. Right, which is true, but Apple also launched a Mac Mini, and the previous Mac Mini looked to us like it was a step in the right direction in terms of user upgradability. It just had easily accessible SODIMM slots. This one does not. There's no expansion whatsoever, and you're stuck with either 8 gigs or 16 gigs of memory built right into the M1 SoC. Of course, one of the advantages of the M1 is the fact that the DRAM is built right into the SoC, so the bad part of that is no future expansion, no upgradability, nothing like that. But the good part of it is that everything from the CPU, GPU, neural processor, everything has direct access to that memory, which, as we've seen exploring AMD's, what's their stupid branding for that again? Smart Access Memory. As we discussed when we tested Smart Access Memory, which allows an AMD Radeon CPU to have full access to a Radeon 6000 series GPU's memory, there can be significant performance gains. We saw anywhere from low to mid single digit performance gains in games using that feature. So depending on how this is laid out, Apple could have even more available bandwidth on its hands, because if you look at something like a GPU, it's connected using PCI Express 16X, and even a Gen 4 link is nothing compared to the type of memory interface you can build by putting a core right next to DRAM and linking them up directly. Of course, we didn't see any performance improvement in productivity applications using Smart Access Memory, so as always, it's gonna come down to developer support as well as the specific architecture to determine what kind of performance improvement you're going to see. Now, one of the things I've seen speculated about the M1 is that because it shares a lot of its heritage with Apple's A series of mobile-first SoCs, and well, that is to say, I mean, a MacBook Air is technically a mobile device, but I think you guys know what I mean, like iPhones and iPads, is that that could be part of the reason why I/O seems, at least on first glance, fairly limited, because something like being able to have 4 Thunderbolt ports on an iPad is obviously a pretty low priority, so it might have been a lot of work to bolt on, and there might have been internal bottlenecks that you would have hit if you tried to actually daisy chain, you know, what is it, 24 devices off the bloody thing. Of course, my expectation was that this is a very first generation attempt at this, and we're going to see big improvements down the line, and I did predict that Apple will abandon these first generation M1 series products relatively quickly. Which isn't to say, though, that I think that they're going to abandon it, you know, immediately, like something like, what's an example of a product that got abandoned completely immediately? Remember that Lenovo Fab thing with like Google Project Tango augmented reality? Okay, that's a product that got really abandoned. I think that this is just gonna be Apple's kind of abandoned. So if you look at something like the software support of the iPad first gen versus the iPad 2, it's like not even close. That's kind of my expectation here, but I would absolutely love to be proven wrong. As for the performance, as for the app compatibility, I mean, the embargo just lifted like a couple of hours before I filmed this thing. Apple did a great job of delivering our system on time, so at least credit to them for that. So I'm going to be leaving that to Anthony to test on his own. One of the big features here is, of course, is that you're not going to be able to run just ARM-compatible versions of programs on this. So Photoshop is something that is notably missing a native app for the new M1 version Macs. But also x86 compatible apps, so you can run Photoshop using Rosetta 2, and also iPad and iPhone apps. So theoretically, this could be like the device that kind of runs it all. Just it remains to be seen with what kind of performance and with what kind of compatibility. It was kind of inevitable if you think about it though. I mean, it's not like Apple's the first to say, okay, you know, screw it. Screw x86, we're going ARM. I mean, Amazon's doing it. Like, it's already happening. Graviton chips, man. If I'm Intel and AMD, I'm sort of wondering what my jam is gonna be if x86 loses its dominance at this point. Have fun, Anthony. This one is going to be an adventure, I think. Speaking of adventures, make sure you're subscribed to Short Circuit so you don't miss any of our first hands-on impressions and adventures with new devices like this one. Man, it has been a busy Techtober, all the way into like Techvember.